program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. I'm Bruce Broussard, your host. Folks, we got quite a show for you today. As you note, the coming week of the 7th, the entire week, we're going to be celebrating the military across the board. Veterans Day is next week. We got the Marine Corps birthday. If you notice, I'm donning my lid here, if you will. But again, simplified to those Marines that are out there. And I've got military personnel here on the show. And we're going to talk about a couple of individuals who are actually very active in promoting some of the organizations and issues that are facing the military here within our community. And so with that, just sit back, relax, and see if we can get this together, okay? All right. Well, right off the bat, joining me to begin this, and actually sort of like leading the show, so to speak, I met this gentleman some times ago, and all of a sudden I find that we had mutual interests, you know, and mutual paths for that matter. He was in the military at one point in time, and I'm talking about Tony here. He happens to be the commander of the Military Order of the Purple Heart. We're going to get a better feel of what that's all about, but I want you to know I met Tony. He's a retired vet himself. I think Air Force, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, Air Force.
No, Army.
Army.
That's okay.
Okay, but I'm getting there. We're all family.
That's true.
Okay, we're all family. But anyway, and so as a result of meeting Tony, he was very instrumental in helping me put together this show to honor, if you will, not only those who are serving today, those who have served before in the past. He's basically saying, and from the public standpoint, you need to know the contributions of our military servicemen and women, okay, on both ends. So with that, we're going to start off by basically talking about the Military Order of the Purple Heart. We're going to talk about that, find out what it is, why it exists, and et cetera, et cetera. And Tony's going to do that for us. He's also brought with him from a chapter standpoint, an assistant of some sort, He's going to introduce that particular person.
Yes.
And then we're going to break. We're going to take a half hour. We're going to take a shot, a little short break. And then we're going to come back with another organization that's doing some things. But in this particular case, it's going to be about the kids, the families, if you will, the kids of the particular families, people who are serving in the service. Unlike when I was in the service and I had family, it wasn't this focus, if you will, and I thought that was interesting. I won't get into the details. That's what we're going to be doing on the second half hour. So with that, let me start off. Tony, how you doing?
I'm doing very well.
That's great. I want you to know you did a great job setting this thing up, and I'm sure that they're looking forward to this entire hour, okay?
Yes.
Appreciate that. And so Tony, let's talk about this business right off the bat. The Military Order of the Purple Heart, what is that?
Okay, well, I'm going to explain that, Bruce, and before I get too far into the explanation and talking a little bit about what we do and our national chapter in the rest, first I'd like to say that I didn't want to cast any aspersions on the Air Force when you asked me was in the Air Force. I am a retiree from the Army. However, the Air Force are our brethren, you know, that the Army Air Corps the Air Force came out of the Army. So we still believe that they're
but
very
since
well
you, but since you brought in that, I got to get back on him again.
Okay.
But the bottom line is that, one, how long did you serve, and where were some of the areas that you served in?
Thanks so much for asking that. I served in the military for 26 years.
26 years.
And I had a very interesting career. I enjoyed it the entire time. The Marines use a term that they call a Mustang. So I think for veterans out there that understand that term, I served as enlisted, I served as a warrant officer, and then I served as commissioned officer as well. Mm-hmm. So I had an opportunity in that 26 years to have a very interesting and varied career, and did a lot of things and enjoyed
it. Any time in NAM, were you a Vietnam vet?
Yes. Okay, we're going to talk a little bit about that.
What part of the area were you in? I was in Da Nang.
Okay. As you know, there are Vietnamese located, and there are a number of corps in it.
Exactly, right.
And I served three tours in Vietnam, so I started off in Quang Tri.
You had a couple.
So that's up in the area of the Da Nang area, just north of that.
Oh, great.
And then Quy Nhon, and then down in the south of Saigon.
Thanks for serving.
That area. My pleasure.
Okay.
And well with you.
Okay,
thank
sir.
You for
all
your
right.
service. I'd like to get back to, well, I want to just sort of set the tone here about the Military Order of Purple Heart. So again, Tony Couch, right now I'm serving as the commander for Chapter 72, the Military Order of Purple Hearts, and I'll come back and talk about that. But with me today, and he will have some more to say, is our newly appointed junior vice. Okay. And his name is Michael Robert.
Okay.
And we're going to spend a lot of time talking to Michael because Michael brings a very interesting contrast to our organization, what we're trying to do, and where we think the future of service organizations is going.
Mm-hmm.
Michael served in Iraq and is also a combat wounded veteran.
Okay.
And so,
like you.
As well.
Right, right.
And we're going to talk a little bit about the Military Order of Purple Hearts, and then I'm going to chime in and bring Michael in. But let me frame this for us. So the Military Order of Purple Hearts is a national organization. They're located in Springville, Virginia. In order to be a member of the Military Order of Purple Heart, one must have been wounded in combat.
Mm-hmm.
And so that serves the criteria. Now, we have about 45,000 members nationally, and the national organization has departments and chapters throughout the Counterintelligence United States. And so I would say our particular chapter is located here in the Portland area, Rose City, and it's Chapter 72.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there are about 300,000 living Purple Heart recipients.
Really?
At present, yes. And our chapter is interesting in that we have 188 members, and they span all of the conflicts from World War II, Korea, Vietnam, and the current Iraqi-Afghanistan Operation New Dawn conflicts as well. So we are a service organization not too unlike the other service organizations in the area. I think most of the public is familiar with American Legion,
mm-hmm.
the DAV, Disabled American Vet, VFW,
mm-hmm.
NAV Vets, National Association of Black Veterans.
Mm-hmm.
So there are a number of service organizations in the area. We are but one,
mm-hmm.
Congressionally chartered, just like the rest of them are, and we have a chapter here. We're the smallest, and I like to say that we do hard work, and of course, we want to be the smallest because the individuals in our organization have all been combat wounded. To the extent that we can keep that down, which is where we want to be.
Right.
But that is a process of the freedoms that we enjoy,
mm-hmm.
Going out and defending a country of both foreign and domestic enemies. So going back to Chapter 72,
okay.
here in Portland, we have a very interesting mission. Before I leave that, I'd like to talk a little bit more about the national service organizations. We also have a national service officer. Her name is Jennifer Burke. She is co-located with the VA, the Veterans Administration, here in Portland. And they serve all veterans. I mean, our real mission is to help veterans, and they do that at no cost to the veterans. And generally, most veterans do not know what benefits they're entitled to. That's the thing that is always a major issue.
Yeah.
And so helping them, getting the word out, appraising them, making them aware of what benefits that they have is not only our mission, but the mission of all the service organizations.
Why is that so, Tony? Have you gotten enough information to get some feedback as to why that is so?
Well, in my opinion, there are two primary issues associated with that. One is when a service member leaves the military, maybe we're not doing an adequate job in briefing him or her as to the benefits that they're entitled to. The second one, which Michael will address a little bit more, understanding the younger vet that's coming back, is that they simply want nothing to do with the military. They want to get away from it and the rest of that. And so they want nothing to do with the military other than probably their educational benefits. We think that that's an issue. That's one of the issues that we want to try to address. It's part of our reaching out to new leadership, bringing more current vets on board from the current conflicts and have it more relevant. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about our mission, and then I want to just bring
then
Michael on board, because
I
think that that's a great question that you brought about. Why is it that they're passing that? Well, our mission, Chapter 72 here in Portland, is to foster an environment of goodwill and camaraderie for combat wounded veterans, and so we hope to do that. The next thing is to promote patriotism. We believe that patriotism and Americanism is a part of our country's heritage. And it's something that's not being taught the way we believe it should be. So we go into the schools, junior ROTC, ROTC, those type of recognition programs. And then most importantly, we want to provide service to veterans and their families in the area, and we believe that that really is significant. Now, I talked a little bit about our membership. Our membership, we probably 17% of our membership is composed of Afghanistan and Iraqi veterans, but we're not getting return from them. They're not coming in and joining these service organizations. We're not sure why. There are a number of opinions as to why that is. And we've talked a little bit about that. But now I want to turn this over to Michael. Mike, if you'd introduce yourself and tell us why you don't think, as a recent Iraqi veteran returning combat wounded, why aren't people?
I'm Mike Robers, and I'm happy to be a part of the organization. And I think the main reason why people don't utilize the programs or come to the chapters and the meetings is because they're trying to get as far away from the issues that they encountered in the war that they're dealing with after coming back from the war. And I did the same thing, and that's how I can speak from personal experiences, is that they're pushing pause on a problem that they need to just play it through, and they need to know that what you're going through is normal. We went through the same stuff. We go through the same stuff every day, but it's not going to go away. But you need to be around people who have been through the same situations so you can feel like you're not the only one out there. Now, you may be different than your friends. You may be different than your family, yes, but that's kind of how it is nowadays. And it's kind of like X-Men or anything like that. You have a special power now. You need to be able to learn how to harness that power and use it for good. A lot of people are turning it inwards and they're not saying anything about it and they're kind of harming themselves. Well, we want to point them in the right direction, let them know what services are out there, how to get there, and let them know that you're not the only one out there. You're just
tell
like
me something,
us.
Mike. Were you active or were you a reservist?
I was active.
You were active.
So
basically, you joined the military, and then you were sent. You were deployed out into that area, right?
Right. It's after 9/11 happened. Okay. I called it upon myself. I said, "This is something I need to do."
Okay. Okay.
And originally, I was thinking about going into the military, but I didn't really quite wanted to pull the trigger per se, and. It all happened, and I just felt like I needed to become part of something greater than myself, or greater than anything that's ever happened. And it was my calling to go, and I did go. And I was stationed in Germany, and I was in the service for about 3 years. And I was in the second year of the Iraq War.
And you were there. Okay. Well, while there in Iraq, I mean, there were a number of reservists. I mean, great number of reservists served in that campaign. Were you able to talk with them and get a feel in terms of whether or not they felt that they were well trained like yourself?
We didn't really, as far as working with the other units and groups, it was more so if we were on a mission, they would come out and help and support, but we didn't really have time to chit-chat because we were moving around a lot.
So they were more in a supportive aspect in your unit, for that matter, as opposed
They were all doing their different elements. So whether they were on primary route patrol and we were on a different route patrol, basically everybody was handling their job, and all those pieces was what it took in order to solve that puzzle of war, and everybody had a job to do.
Could I just come back and comment on something Mike said? Because you asked him, were the reservists in a reserve role? And I would say that that's really not the case anymore. And I don't want to forget the National Guard.
Right.
The National Guard, reserve, and active component all form our current force. And what we found out is that we've had to rely on the National Guard and the Reserve very heavily during this past 10 years in terms of the conflict. And my hat's off to Oregon. The more I understand the Oregonians and their citizen soldier profile, few people know that the state of Oregon has deployed more National Guardsmen to these conflicts. In Iraq and Afghanistan than any other state.
Wow.
So it really does speak to the citizen soldier here and the particular issues that affect that soldier when they return, whether it's soldier, Marine, airman, sailor. All of those pieces are key pieces. Now, I think Mike was bringing out a very interesting point that as an active component, that was just one leg of this three-component service effort that we have with the National Guard and the Reserve. So they're all doing a yeoman's job. We want to recognize all of them, particularly during this week as we approach, as you said, Veterans Day and all Military Week.
And you made mention that maybe we could spend a little bit more time on this as what are your goals for helping the Oregon veterans?
Right? Yeah, and thanks so much for asking for that. Sure. There's a number of things that our chapter has taken on. First, our goal is to help all veterans and their family, whether they're combat wounded or not. You simply have to be combat wounded to be a member of our organization.
Yeah, that's right.
But our organization is our real focus is helping veterans overall. And there are a number of programs that we set up. One is called the VAVS, which is Veterans Affairs Voluntary Services. We spend countless hours in both the Portland and the Vancouver hospital with our members helping and saving, and in terms of cost benefit to the hospital, thousands of dollars every year.
How do you go about doing
that? What our members do is they go up to both the Portland VA hospital and the Vancouver hospital, and they volunteer. They go around, they assist the veterans that are in the hospitals. They go through the hospital assisting the staff. So anything that we can do to help veterans, that saves the Veterans Administration thousands of dollars. Mm. I mean, hundreds of thousands of dollars every year.
So there is a volunteer corps, so to speak.
There is a volunteer corps within that. And each service component, each national service organization, whether it's the DAV, VFW, American Legion, NAV, VET, all of those individuals have volunteers to do that. I just want to speak to the Military Order of Purple Heart and our efforts to do that.
Right, exactly.
The other program is Americanism. We think that that's a huge piece. We're going to be asking Mike, as our junior vice, who really is our PR guy, to take a harder look at that. And he's got some programs that I'm going to let him address here. But we want to go into schools. We want to instill patriotism and Americanism. And as you know, I won't belabor this point too much, but we've had the Portland Public School System just recently came out with a decision on having counter-recruiters in, which we support wholeheartedly because we believe that that's what we're out here for, fighting those First Amendment rights, people having the opportunity to say that. So those are some of the programs. I know that Mike has got, as our newly elected public relations individual, he's got some ideas. You want to share a few of them in terms of program?
A couple of ideas that I have is that I want to get together with existing programs that are out there, with different organizations like Tony was mentioned, that are out there doing things and being active in the community, because we want to be able to have these vets, give them a place to go and then something to do. So that way that can increase camaraderie, but it's also about leading from the front. The same reason why we joined the military in the first place was we answer to a higher calling for something greater than ourselves, right? And we always lead from the front. Same thing is going to go when it comes to volunteering and getting the word out there, is we're going to put our best foot forward. We're going to try and help people. And then in return, while we're doing good, we're going to be able to help some soldiers that are dealing with some other internal issues as well. I know myself personally, if I go out there and I do a good deed from somebody, I feel really good about it and I feel content. Well, a lot of people don't get that contentment because there isn't a lot of events or things lined up that they can go participate on them. Mm-hmm. So we're going to use existing programs out there instead of creating our own, in essence, so we can start getting things going to where we can have something going on every Sunday. So that way, if you're not doing anything, you want to come and you want to show your support, you're a disabled vet, or you're a vet for that matter, we would love to have you and we'd love to start getting events going. Because the main thing is if you stay busy and you're doing good for everybody else, then you're going to feel good about yourself. And then also what we want to do is we want to start increasing member participation as well as driving in new members. Now, the way we're going to do that is we're going to start putting the word out about what we're doing, is giving them a place to go and things to do. Now, the other second thing is we want to get everything going virtual as well to give them an alternative way to be able to attend the meeting. So that way, if you live, let's say, 200-300 miles away and you can't make it to the meeting, we'll just jump in online, log in, and then you'll be able to see us, and then you'll be able to interact with us as we're having the meeting on the Sunday. So what that'll do is that it'll give you an opportunity to feel like you're part of the mission and part of the process. And we want to be able to have people mold together as a team so that way we can achieve support and we can achieve healing and some successful solutions for vets and helping others out there in the community.
Mm-hmm. Now, you know, I was on another question I would ask. You know, we talked about Chapter 72 and the 194
Absolutely.
Members or whatever.
Right.
And we're talking about men and women that they basically
yes.
receive. What percentage, if you will, of the 194 were women?
Okay, I'm glad you asked that question as well. I just recently reviewed our chapter roster, and we have 4 members that are women, not associate members. I'm going to talk about associate membership in a moment. One of our Iraqis.
These were wounded?
Yeah, this is a soldier that was shot in the chest.
Okay.
So we have wounded women in our chapter, and that is simply reflective of the military mm-hmm. and the role that women are taking and standing up. I went to a program last week, the Massing of the Colors, and it was held here in Portland. And one of the speakers, who was a Marine, had said that they just recently activated the first Marine female combat aviator. And so it just goes to show where we're going. This conflict has asked for a large participation from all citizens, men and women. And women serve a vital part in the military and do a great job for us in that regard. To dovetail on what Mike was saying, our chapter really is about building programs in the community. And so, and what's really interesting about this, we haven't always had the funds to do that. So in talking to you today, my message is a call to action, number one, for our members.
Okay.
So we've got to do a better job of what we've done in the past. We're beyond the point where members just come and tell a war story. I think today's member wants to have an opportunity to show that camaraderie and talk a little bit about what's happened. That's very important. But beyond that, to give their time up, they want to be involved in a program. They want to be involved in an action issue that's helping others. And so I'm making a call of action to our members. If they're watching that program, we're going to get on board with some programs. And now you know that you got to have the beans and bullets to do that. And we're very fortunate that we haven't always had the funds in our chapter to do that. There were 2 significant events in our chapter's development here in the last year. One was our previous commander, Gary Grange, had a fundraiser where he was involved with Portland Sportsman Expo and raffled a pistol off, and we were able to raise some money that way as part of a fundraiser. Mm-hmm. The second one is we were very fortunate that our junior vice, Mike here, wears a couple of hats.
Mm.
One of his hats is junior vice, PR, public relations for our chapter. The other one is he is the president of Securus. Now, both him...
Why don't you pan over there,
yeah.
Dave? Pan that over on the...
Right.
Right.
Him and an individual named Steve Lima, who is the...
Okay.
He is the CEO,
okay.
Have come together and given us a cash donation of $1,500 this month to assist vets and vets and their families and a portion of their profits monthly. So we may be asking other businesses to support us so that we can support vets. Mikey, put your president hat on now and tell us a little bit about Securus.
And by the way, do you happen to have a website? We're not promoting business, but the fact that you are a business person, mm-hmm. you have a website? What's your site?
It's securuspayments.com, securuspayments.com. And, the story, the way the company started was, is that when I got out of the military, I didn't really have anywhere to go. I couldn't mm-hmm. live off the monthly compensation. And I couldn't go, be CIA and all these FBI and all these cool mm-hmm. things you want to be as a kid, you mm-hmm. know. So I really had nowhere to go. So I started in sales and, I learned the business and we sell the Visa machine. So every time that you swipe your Visa or MasterCard to pay for something, they're charged a portion of the sale.
Okay.
So we set up small to medium sized businesses with the service and then mm-hmm. try to drop the rates down for them.
Mm-hmm.
But I got into the business and, I started as a sales rep and I was always traveling on the road. I was always gone from my family. I was always putting the company and the interest of them and myself, as well as furthering my career, in front of my own needs. And by doing that, I learned the business inside out, and it came a point where I called my friend Steve, whom I've known since I was about 14 years old, and I was saying, look, we should do this together.
Put it together.
Yeah, he knows the back end. I know the sales side.
Right.
Let's get together and let's start something wonderful. And if it wasn't for the support of our friends, whom are actually the leadership within our organization, we got Mike Hook, who is our COO, a good friend I've known since I was 14. We have Aaron Plotsky, who lived with me in California when I was down there selling, and he knows the sales side, so he's the president of sales. And then we have our other friend, Ryan Brown, who's the director of marketing. So all these people that we grew up with are now the leaders of our organization, and the following from all of our friends and family members and support from everybody has been tremendous. And we started from Steve's kitchen table, me out in the field going to selling. And, you know, I was living with my grandmother at the time. Basically, we had 2 weeks to get a sale because we went outsourced for the appointments. And if we didn't do that, I don't know what I would be doing today.
Well, so as a result, now you're in business, mm-hmm. and at the same time, you want to give back. And I,
yeah, correct.
And all of a sudden, Tony correct. Comes into the picture,
yep.
and knowing how he is a salesperson, like he got me.
Well, really, I didn't have to tell him much. He's no, a veteran.
No, he's
wedded to this.
I like that.
And
like this.
He
like
was
that.
Wedded to this yes. Concept. And we got him on board with the organization. And so the first thing as a businessman, he said, how can I help?
Yeah, great, great.
So here's the key. We're going to take his donation and multiply it. And so we're trying to figure out how to multiply our efforts through others.
And that's and that
so
outreach. That's the thing.
Yeah, that's
getting
the other,
out there and,
that's
and
the,
identifying
that's
those. You know, a point, something that came up in regards to, do you happen to have a listing or do you happen to have knowledge as to the vets that are in this area that were wounded?
Okay, and I'm glad you asked that question. We're just starting to get that type of information.
What kind of number do you have?
First, I got to give some kudos here. Julie Parrish,
who is five more,
and I'll be really brief. Julie Parrish, who's a state representative for District 37 down at Clackamas College County, does a great job. But I want to talk a little bit about her husband, Colonel Parrish, who is the deputy for the 41st Brigade, has told me that he will identify those Purple Hearters for us.
In the area.
In Oregon. And we're talking about National Guardsmen and Reserve.
Yeah.
I mean, National Guardsmen primarily.
Yeah.
But here's an example. The 3rd of the 116th Cavalry, which just returned from Iraq, they're going to have a post-deployment on the 19th of November at Clackamas Community College.
Okay.
Talking to the Sergeant Major, they have 50 Purple Hearters.
Wow.
50 individuals were awarded Purple Heart. 200 were awarded combat aviation or combat action badges. So it really does speak to the involvement.
They're not part of the 194.
They're not part of the 194.
Wow.
As a matter of fact, we'd like to get them on board. We want to sign them up.
Right.
You know, that's the key right there. We want to sign them up.
Okay. You know, as I think about that, you know, I remember when I went to NAM, and then all of a sudden I got back stateside, you know what I'm saying? You had your packet.
Yes.
You got me, your exit packet, so to speak, even when you got out of service or whatever. And is that part of parcel of outreaching and putting something in that packet?
Well, yes. Yes and no. First, let me say yes. You were active duty?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so when you got out, here's the dilemma that affects Oregonians. There's no active military base here. So when Mike got out, he processed out in an active duty military base. In Oregon, we do not have the National Guard. They've got Camp Withicum. They've got a couple of other armories around the state. So they have a challenge. But they're doing a wonderful job. They've got this program called pre- and post-deployment, mm-hmm. where they try to take care of the soldier prior to leaving and when they get back. So this...
And they've been doing some great jobs.
And they have been doing some great jobs.
Cardwell.
Yes,
Cardwell
has
done a lot in the legislature to do some things for, i.e., Oregon Guards folks and military.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I mean, we just recently had an issue up at Fort Lewis where, mm-hmm. you know, the Oregon senator had to go up there and say, hey, treat my people good up here along those lines.
Senator
in terms
Ron
of,
Wyden.
Yeah,
Senator
in terms
Ron
of returning and arrest.
Yes.
So the National Guard is doing a great job. We're trying to couple with them and see where we can identify and help. Small but mighty. And when we have businesses like Securus that's behind us, we're going to be able to multiply that effort.
Well, you've got PCM, too, Portland Cable Medium here.
There you go.
You've got the Oregon Voter right here.
All right.
And we're going to invite you all anytime you want to come back, Tony, and let us be a part of that outreach program.
Do I get the idea that we're getting ready to go away?
Oh, no way.
Yeah. I just want to say that Veterans Day is coming up on November 11th. And to all of our listeners out here.
And Marine Corps birthday next year.
And we don't want to forget the Marine Corps birthday, 236. So,
yes,
on the 10th.
Yes, sir.
And then on the 11th. So reach out to a veteran. Every individual that's a veteran in your family, call them. Participate in our hamlets, communities, wherever you can, to recognize the great job that our servicemen and women are doing.
Fantastic.
And
Mike,
like to thank
thanks
you.
Very much for the involvement, if you will, from a business standpoint, but also being part of the organization. It's going to be just great getting together with you guys and kind of getting the feel for where you're going. We want to help educate the public out there, because that was the other point real quick I was was going to ask, is that if there are families out there, and your loved one was either, you got a Purple Heart or was wounded in the military, whether present or past or whatever, hey, here's the guy to call and get them involved. And in fact, that activity, actually being involved and building up that camaraderie and meeting other folks would really help the situation. Because a lot of times, alcohol plays a major role.
It does.
A lot of the
right.
vets. Yeah. And the only way you can get off of that situation is to be around folks who have actually participated like you have.
Absolutely.
Goes back to turning it in.
That's right. So I tell you what we're going to do. Thanks
very
much.
We meet the second Sunday of every month, DAV Bingo Hall.
That's right.
On Sandy Boulevard.
Okay.
Second Sunday of every month.
Now, what if you're not a Purple Heart recipient? Can you
come
still
on,
come?
Come on by.
Okay,
come
good.
On
That's
by.
That's a good
we'd
idea.
Like
good
yeah, come
Tony,
on
you're
by.
Going to be coming back on the show. We're going to take a short break, and we're going to be right back with our second half. Okay?
All right.
Mike, it's a pleasure. Okay, bud. Good job.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Okay, welcome back, folks. So we're back here at Oregon Voters Digest again. Make sure that you celebrate Veterans Day. There are many activities starting on the 7th, which is Monday, through the entire week, if you will, about military of all particulars. And that's why we're doing this show today. We want to educate you. Get involved. It's very important, very patriotic. It's the thing to do. It's the American way of doing things. Okay, you saw the first half hour. If you notice, Tony was the one that basically initiated the show. He's basically the lead person in this particular situation. He talked about the Order of the Purple Heart, and now he's talking about other organizations. He's reaching out to many organizations, if you will, as it relates to veterans, both men and women, if you will, and which is really a marvelous effort on his part and others, for that matter, across the board. And we have one such organization here with us today, and I'm going to let Tony give the opportunity to introduce this particular group. And then we'll just go ahead and do questions and answers, okay?
Thank you so much. Again, picking up where we left off, we're talking about the Military Order Purple Heart and some of the community reach-outs that we wanted to do. Well, I was very fortunate to meet an individual named Tina Olson, who is a veteran advocate, and she talked a little bit about a workshop that was coming up that addressed military children. What happens to children in this area when either one or both of their parents deploy? National Guard, Reserve, and the rest of that, and that happens quite a bit. And so we were able to attend a training, and so I would like to, one of our individuals that attended the training was Karen Haltner, and Karen, she's going to say hello in a moment, but let me talk a little bit about her. Karen does a lot of things. She is the past national president for the Ladies Auxiliary for Military Order of Purple Heart. And when I mentioned this reach out, she immediately said, I want to get involved.
Okay.
I see a great connection here.
Good.
Now, with us also is Matthew Vanderlung, who is a trainer, and he's going to tell you more about that. Mm-hmm. But he travels around the country training advocate groups on making them aware of the military child in the community and what type of issues or challenges may be present. So, Matthew?
And by the way, before you jump in there, man, now they have two childs, right? Two types of kids. One on base, military base.
Absolutely.
And then people outside, off base.
Exactly.
And,
that,
and the people off base really have a challenge.
Right.
With that,
precisely.
Matt, welcome aboard.
Thank you.
And you too, Karen.
Thank you.
So, like I said, or like Tony said for me, I'm with the Military Child Education Coalition.
Okay.
And the particular event he was talking about was our public engagement in Oregon, which was about 2 weeks ago now. And the biggest reason we have these public engagements is we're going to every state in the union, or at least that's our goal. And we particularly like coming to a state like Oregon because Oregon is unique in that it has no active duty military bases. And so all you have are the National Guard and the Army Reserves, or the Reserves and the National Guard. And so the question becomes, how do we get resources to those people when they're not localized at a military base, like you were saying? Because you have those kinds of children that it's very easy to get support to. And then you have the children that are sort of spread out through the civilian community. An interesting factoid that we discovered in our own research of Oregon was that 7% of all Oregon public school children are dependents of military, whether it's reservist or guard. That number, however, does not include grandchildren of active duty or reserve or guard. It does not include children related to veterans, children whose siblings are necessarily in the military, or families that have relocated to Oregon after someone else is deployed. So that number is probably much closer to 10%, just by my estimation. So that's one child in 10 in Oregon public schools has a direct connection to someone who is active duty military or has been activated, which means the need of our organization is very big here because we want to come in and we want to talk about why these children need our help, why we want to focus on these children, and why we need to cater to them and help educate and build resilience within
them. And that's a good question. I'll throw it right back to you. So why this focus need, if you will, on these kids?
A lot of programs, a lot of programs today focus specifically on the soldier or the family. And a lot of people assume that there's just a trickle-down effect. You help the soldier, then it, obviously it's going to help his family, it's going to help his children. The children, a lot of people, it's unfair to say that a lot of people fail to realize this, but they're people too, just younger children, but just younger. So by talking to them and explaining to them, like, this is what happens when a parent deploys. This is the process of grief. Strengthening them, giving them a good support network, building resilience within them, allows them to be able to handle it that much better. So we target the children and sort of let that trickle upwards into the family. That way there's just support all around for helping the families survive a deployment or a changed parent or something like that.
So tell me something. You know, every so often from a layman's standpoint, you know, you look at TV and this, that, and the other doing Christmas time or Thanksgiving time. You might see on national television, for instance, a profile where a dad might be talking to to his kid, you know, statewide and whatever. Is that something that you all participate in?
In a way, what we do, the biggest thing we do is just raise awareness.
Just raise awareness, okay.
The biggest thing we do is raise awareness. Okay. In particular, we focus on sort of seven sectors within each state.
Okay.
We go for community and civic leaders.
Okay.
We go for faith-based organizations, education, healthcare, service providers, service organizations, and the last one is escaping me. Of course, that would happen.
Now, how do you do that in public schools? That's something they require.
And that's a good point.
Yeah.
And we'll come back to
the
seventh one for you.
All right, Tony.
I'd like to just get it down usable form for the public. And that is when if a child in school is having behavioral issues or their grades are falling off, does the teacher know? Has the Portland Public School System, has the Oregon Public School System identified whether or not that child is the child of a parent that's deployed overseas? Or in some cases, where both parents have deployed overseas. And a child now, care is being provided by grandparents or an aunt or an uncle or a friend. So we don't know all of these questions.
So is that noted to the teacher?
Well, we don't know that. I don't know whether or not.
But is that part of the goals?
That is part of the goal. That's where we want to go. That would be part of the goal. Right.
Good.
And Ken, what do you think about that, since we pulled you into this right away?
Well, the program is very good. I learned a lot at the workshop, and I would highly recommend anyone, if they can, to go to one, because it does gives you an insight on how the kids need help and how we can help them. And HIPAA's hard, you know, you got to get past HIPAA. Hmm. But
what is HIPAA?
That's the Privacy Act.
A privacy act.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
There's some things we just cannot get unless they give it to us.
Now, this is a nonprofit organization, I take it, right?
Right.
Yes. Is this also endorsed by the military organization?
Yes.
The Defense Department?
Yeah. Well, what was really interesting at our training and dinner, one of the speakers was Mrs. Shinseki. So the wife of the current VA, the VA secretary, General Shinseki. Mm. So there is a push, and as you well know, Michelle Obama has been focused on the military family and what's happening to the military family. And that, like Matthew said, we're looking at the soldier, we're looking at the family, and I just think we have to bore down a little deeper and take a look at the impact on children. You know, we talk about post-traumatic stress syndrome, and we can talk about that at different levels along those lines. A child can get in a very stressful situation also at a very crucial and developmental time in their life.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
This training, how long does it take?
Yeah.
So the training that we offer lots of different kinds of trainings.
What kind of thing? Yeah,
the particular one that we did recently was just called the public engagement. It's simply a two-day event where we have dinner the previous night and then sort of a day-long training the next day. And what we do is we bring together, based on sort of the steering committee that we previously contact within the state, and they nominate a bunch of people in different organizations around the state. And these people come together, and we basically talk about military children and the issues confronting them. And then the second half of the day, these people actually build an action plan for their specific state to implement pretty much as soon as we leave. The grand metaphor that we use in the Military Child Education Coalition is we're the wedding planners. The Department of Defense has paid for us to come in, we've set up everything, and then once we leave, it is the state's obligation to actually further these plans and go forward with them.
Okay, and by whom?
The people at the public engagement. And
now, what about our superintendent? We got our superintendent of public education here, Susan Castile, for that matter.
Okay.
Have you maybe outreached to her to kind of give her a feel for
what? Off the top of my head, I can't remember if she was at the public engagement.
Okay. Okay.
And the other sector that I couldn't remember earlier.
That'd be a good source.
It would be. And I'm sure that
she could kind of send it out throughout the state.
Portland Public School System or Oregon Public Schools had a representative at this training.
We had a lot of educational representatives.
We had a lot of educational representatives.
I know Susan.
So we're going to get them.
She's very committed, if you will, to the kids, especially that area. All kids, for that matter.
Okay? Absolutely.
Right. That's bottom line.
So very concerned.
Because I can see that as part, I don't know what any particulars, if you will, that you're sort of addressing in this training situation with kids. Do you do it with groups or a group of kids? Or do you actually involve yourselves with the kids?
We don't directly involve ourselves with the children, but we do have a lot of resources. There's a lot of research behind what we've done. In particular, the research of Dr. Paula Rausch, Dr. Ken Ginsberg on building resilience within children. Both of them work specifically in the area of child psychology around military families. And we actually partnered with Sesame Workshops and created a series of DVDs all about how children deal with these kinds of changes.
Oh, you have those.
And they're actually available directly from our website, themilitarychild.org. All of them are free download. You can also order hard copies of the DVDs directly from the website.
So maybe in our libraries and our educational system would be an ideal opportunity there.
And I like their handle. They have a slogan that they use, and it's called Living the New Normal. Mm-hmm. And so for our children, they're going to be living the new normal. And the new normal is that in a citizen soldier state like Oregon, parents are deployed. One or two parents may be deployed. It may not come home for a while or may come home injured. And so then what is the new normal for that child?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I know that Karen has done some work with Army Strong, Barb McCain over there.
Right.
And so tell us a little bit about that.
Well, it's a place in the Clackamas Community College that they have opened up. It's called Army Strong, and it's to help with the veterans on campus. Mm. They can take their children there while they're in class and just...
At no cost, babysitter?
No, it's no cost. No cost.
Good.
And they can just be normal little kids.
Hmm.
I do not know the age limit, but I've been there and they got baby stuff. So,
mm-hmm,
and
mm-hmm.
toddler stuff. And, of course, the school-age kids would be going to their own school. Mm-hmm. So I'm assuming it would be the children up to kindergarten mm-hmm. age.
So I take it all families that have kids, you know, are outreach, is that part of the packet, if you will, when they come back on stateside?
Definitely.
That's available to them?
Mm-hmm.
The average age of the soldier nowadays is only 27.
Right.
So a lot of these soldiers have families rather than, like, the image of the single male as a soldier is a dying idea because so many soldiers have families now. And there's, like we said, a lot of women in the military, a lot of married families in the military. Right. And so the average age of a child of these soldiers is very young.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's why a lot of these child care services are arising. I know the Boys and Girls Club in Oregon is very active in this. The YMCA, the YWCA, they're all very dedicated to making sure that there are options for young children available to help support families that have a parent deployed or both parents deployed.
And that's something we've got to think about because I'm reminded of when I joined the military back in the mid-60s and the old cliche was, if the Army wanted you to have a wife, they would have what? Issued you one.
Right.
Well, that's not the case now. 60% of our soldiers, sailors, airmen, and Marine are married.
Mm-hmm.
And so with that comes families along and the responsibilities. And I think we're thinking about a two-prong approach in helping the returning soldier, be it him or her, and we've all just got to include the children in that, living that new normal also.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that the Ladies Auxiliary of the Military Order of Purple Heart, they're about to award some money to Army Strong. You want to talk about that?
Yeah. Every year, the national president has a charity that she picks. Her own picking. We don't have to get approval from anyone. And I picked Army Strong, and I will be giving Barbara a check to help with Army Strong.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So it's something, it's called the Martha Washington Spirit Award. Hmm. Almost said the other Martha. But it's been going on with the Ladies Auxiliary National level for quite a few years. And, well, not quite a few. Probably about 5-6 years it's been going on.
Why don't you share with the audience again a little bit about the auxiliary? What's the purpose of the auxiliary, and what do you do, and how do you outreach? And can one volunteer? Can you sign some folks up now?
Yeah, as long as their husband or son has a Purple Heart, they can join the auxiliary. If they're
all women. All women.
All women.
All right.
Yes. The ladies, yes. It's the ladies.
The ladies,
and we do not have men, I'm sorry, on our side because we are congressional and it comes from Congress that we have to change it. So it can be just the auxiliary, but right now it's the ladies auxiliary.
Ladies auxiliary,
and the purpose of the ladies auxiliary is to assist in furthering and perpetuating the objects of the military or the Purple Heart of the USA, as set forth in Article 3 of the Constitution of the National Corporation. Particularly that part pertains to assisting, comforting, and aiding all members and their dependents.
Okay, now do you have to be a Purple Heart recipient?
The way I was able to join the auxiliary is my husband, Robert, has the Purple Heart.
Okay.
Now, if my son, Rob, had a Purple Heart, I could join the auxiliary.
Okay.
As an auxiliary member.
But there has to be an affiliation with
the
Purple Heart.
It has to be a blood relative, like if it would be my son. But with my husband, it's not my blood, it's just by marriage.
Okay. And or any lineal descendant.
Right,
so,
yeah.
So you want to say that also. Stepson, stepdaughter.
It's mothers, wives, widows, sisters, daughters, granddaughters, adopted daughters, stepdaughters, and direct lineal female descendants of combat veterans of wars of the United States.
Okay. And no problem with if one wants to support the auxiliary.
No, we
one can support, right?
One can support us.
Okay.
Yes.
How do they go about doing that? You have a website of some sort?
Well, they can go on to the Purple Heart website in Portland.
Oh, really?
The ladies just contact, you know, and with them. We don't have our own website. We let them do it.
Okay.
It's the easy out.
Okay.
And just go there, and there's information on there about the auxiliary. Or you can go to the National's website, which is purpleheart.org.
Okay.
It's www.purpleheart.org. That's the National.
Okay.
That's the National website.
Okay, good. Now let's get back to my friend Matt real quick. Like,
yes.
Do we have a website so one can get a little bit more information in regards to the Military Child Education Coalition?
Definitely. Our website is simply militarychild.org, and that's our international organization.
Militarychild.org.
Correct. Okay. And that's our organization's main website. From there, you can become a member of our organization and sort of join in with the training process and learning more about it. You can get involved. You can request people to come to your state or request specific materials, everything like that. Also, within Oregon itself, just from the conference, I learned about a lot of resources available here. And one in particular that I was very proud to learn about and that is already active is called the Oregon Military Assistance Helpline. Mm. And they have a website and a 24/7 phone line available. So any military family that needs any sort of support can call this line, tell them what they need, and the helpline can hook them up with whatever they can.
Whether former or active or whatever. You know,
exactly.
As long as you're military.
Yeah,
right?
Exactly.
Correct.
And families of. Or maybe friends who might, a person might be living with someone who has to be military. Because the bottom line is that's that need. That's that outreach.
Precisely.
And I know Tony's working on that because maybe at some point in time on his future website, he'll probably have a listing of all the groups. I know he's trying to get to all the groups now in terms of outreach from his particular program. And, I'm excited about that.
Mm-hmm. And our chapter, Chapter 72 of the Military Order Purple Heart, we're very excited about this alliance. We believe that this is a fantastic effort for us to get behind. 11,500 children in this state associated with deployed parents one way or the other. And so there's got to be some help there. And we believe, like Matt said, it's just a question of coalescing those resources. They're already here. How do we bring them together? And how do we bring it up on the radar for all of us?
Well, I think it's a great deal, and when I'm thinking now, tell me this about public service announcement. Are you getting the support from public service announcements in regular newspapers and TV and radio? Are they responding by being a part of this team? Because you know, hey, you got to say something to those individuals who are basically fighting for the rights of everybody that's here.
Right.
You know, I know I've served. I know others served.
Right.
Some weren't able to serve. You know, they serve in other capacities.
Right.
You know, so it's very important that we understand that. That's what it's all about. That's what this country is all about.
No, you're absolutely right.
So
public service announcement, I have to be careful. I got to dance around this because
you're here at the Oregon Voters Digest.
Yes,
that's what we're doing.
We haven't always gotten the response that we want. Let me say that. We're trying to sound a clarion call for veterans and their rights. Some of these veterans have been wounded. We're in a tremendous fiscal cut right now, all over. We're looking at a lot of things. And so what we want to make sure is that we don't negate on that promise that we made to veterans.
Right.
So we've got to stand vigilant to that point, stand vanguard, that we've got to hold that line. And we want to hold that line in any way we can. Now, going back to PSAs, we were very fortunate in our relationship with recently here with the Oregonian.
Oh, did you?
We had to have a little bit of a meeting of the mind. We sent them a public service announcement, and they called us back and said, well, you got to pay for this. And we went like, wait a minute. This is a public service announcement. It's really about military assisting veterans in the area and the rest. After we explained who we were and what we were after, the Oregonian got behind us 100%. They sent a reporter over, and they sent a camera person over to one of our meetings and actually ran an article in the Oregonian about the Military Order Purple Heart. So we're real pleased with the Oregonian. We can't say that we've gotten that type of response from all of the news outlets here in Portland.
Which however, they should do, by the way.
And however, we will be pursuing that. Maybe they don't understand our goal and our mission. Maybe we're not talking to the right person. So we're going to start, yeah. You know, that old Christian tune, Let It Begin With Me. We're going to start with we're the problem initially. But when I come back on your program, I'm going to be calling some names out, and I hope that we'll have a good report card.
Well, I know there are two people in town, one of which has retired and from the Oregon.
Okay.
I'm talking about Fred Stickle.
Okay.
And his son. You know, Fred was a former Marine. Actually, his son was also, too. And they were always very pro-military, if you will. And so he sort of set the stage. I know that he was always pro-military along the line. The other person, all due respect, sitting down when I admit sometimes people don't identify with his politics, is Lars Larson.
Okay.
Lars is very pro-military, et cetera. In fact, his dad was in the military at one point in time, and he basically received a number of service. But he's very pro-military aspect of it. So I would say KXL, that you contact them, and they'd be more than glad to give you that good information. You
know, I will pursue
that information out there, too.
Absolutely.
And I would suggest all of them. That's Bernie Foster, the Scanner newspaper. You know, Bernie was a former Air Force person, and he's the owner of the Scanner newspaper. And I would suggest give him a call. And I'm sure he'll accommodate you. He was a former member of the Buffalo Soldiers, et cetera. And we've got a Buffalo Soldiers Association here. I happen to be a lifetime member of the Buffalo Soldiers Association. And that's one of the reasons why I'm outreaching today. And we're going to continue to outreach. In fact, what we might do, we might put together a little ad for you on my program to run on an ongoing basis, at least a website to go. This is where you can actually access services for the military from that particular website. Fair?
Fair, absolutely.
Okay. Anything else? Any lasting comments? How about you, Karen?
If you go on to you're talking about helping the children too. There is a website on the military child.
Okay.
It's called Ask Aunt Peggy.
Ask Aunt Peggy.
Yeah, isn't that mm-hmm. it? Yeah.
All and one she, word, right?
Right.
Yeah, and she will help. If you have a child that's going into school in one state, and they're moving to another state, she can help you with what you can do to...
Really?
But yeah, go on to... It's cool. It's an Ask Aunt Peggy. Yeah.
Well, I'm really excited, so, folks, about everything that you brought to the table. Tony, I take my hat off to you, and I'm sure many veterans in this community, the state for that, may really appreciate the effort that you're making. I've had the time to spend with you, and you, buddy, you are there. You are a Rockwilder when it comes to making sure that these veterans and their families are getting the support and are aware of the services available. And we really need that because too often, parents, family members don't really realize the PTS, if you will. I mean, we just came up with this term, so to speak,
right.
in the Iraqi
Absolutely.
War, whatever. But
right.
we've got veterans that are still suffering today. That, you know, that are older gentlemen, et cetera, and people don't understand that. So now they're going to be able to have access. So thank you very much for being a part of that.
Thank you.
Appreciate you for
having us on.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Okay? Again, as I've always said, back to what you believe in, according to George Page. Have a good one. I'll see you next week with another good show. Take care. Simplify.